Hi, we're back to part two of Mary Pierce. She's a player who reached the ranking, the most recent high ranking of four. And this is a story. It's a bit of a series because she has really used her fate to reach out and help people. And I'm thankful for that. So I want to give people as much information as I can. So we pick up where she's at the French Open. She played in the finals. The next year, it was either that year or the next year, I can't remember, but I've learned that people will approach me to reach players. This is very common, okay? They'll try to get to players through me. And I just basically say, I'm sorry, I can't give you emails, I can't give you phone numbers, and so forth. You know, I can't introduce you to players. And that's kind of what happened. There was a person who had come into the French Open through a player, and that player, who is a retired player, Gene Mayer, came to me and said, do you know who this person is? And I said, no. I was wondering why he gave him access with his credential if he didn't really know who he was, but that's what he said to me. I said, no. And he said, okay. And that person came to me and said, where is Mary Pierce? And I didn't know who he was. And I said, I'm sorry, I don't know where she's at. Even though I knew her mother was sitting in the corner of the restaurant with her brother, he didn't know who they were. And so he, about 15 minutes later, this person came back, and I came back in the player's lounge, and I noticed that he's sitting over, he's standing at the table talking to them. So it was really clear that he was targeting that family to me, okay? And he's a Christian. He came in and introduced himself as a Christian. So, you know, I thought it was odd, and I felt very uncomfortable with that. So I went over later on, talked to the family, and because he started a conversation, he spoke French and English, he could go in there and he started a relationship with the family. So all of a sudden he's around now, whereas before he wasn't around. And I shared that with him. I said, this was the circumstance, and you know, they just chose to accept his friendship. And the mother returned home, and Mary was being invited to the church that this man attended. They had a branch church in Paris, and you know, she started to try to go out because she was very interested in going to different churches. I went to different churches with her in Paris, and I went to the March for Jesus with her, and we went with some church brothers and sisters, and so he invited her there, and I was just curious. I mean, I felt very uncomfortable about how that had transpired. And then during that time, this man who is Mary, he's from Mauritius, his wife wasn't there, so he was single by himself. You know, he came out and he asked Mary. I was with him and Mary, and we're in a car. He had Mary, if I remember right, either he had a car or Mary had a car, and we're driving around Paris, and he asked her out in the evening time to go show her the sights of Paris. Now, you know, for a Christian brother, that's a bit odd. You're married, you really shouldn't do that with a single young lady. It's a bit odd, to say the least, and there was nothing I could do. I got out of the car, and Mary agreed to it. She said, yeah, let's get together later and, you know, show me around the Paris in the nighttime. And then from that moment on, there was this bonding of this church and this person, and then he started to invite a lot of people from the church, the founder of the church and different people from the church, and she was surrounded by these people, and they're from a church in Mauritius, which is very controversial, and even I feel it's a cult, and they were just surrounding her. And then because I was still had a relationship with Mary, a close friendship with her, and I, you know, do Bible studies with them, they kind of had to include me. They talked to me and they were befriending me, but my guard was definitely up. And I went to the church there in Paris that they had, and I listened to the founder speak and his wife, and the message sounded fine until they got about the last 15 minutes of the message, of the sermon, and they started talking about how all the churches in the world were wrong except their church, that there was something wrong with the churches in the world, and that they were that they had the answer to the problems of the churches. Well, that's a cult, you know, and I knew right away that wasn't a place I wanted to go. But Mary, because she's a new Christian, and she had all these people around who were ministering to her in a in a love way, because you know she had some problems with her father and with her family situation, and all of a sudden there were people around her who were caring for her and giving, we call it love bombing, just giving her a lot of affection, including the founders. And so, you know, these are very odd things. And her brother she wouldn't even give her brother a credential to get into the tournament. And it made her brother very angry, and it broke the relationship for a while. That's what I know. And she gave the credentials to these people from this church. So all of a sudden, there were about 10 or 15 people from this church, from Mauritius, that all had credentials because she was well known among the French Tennis Federation. And I heard from people who worked with the French Tennis Federation, they weren't happy about giving out so many credentials to Mary's friends. But she had some influence, and she's a nice person. And so she, all of a sudden, we had about 10 or 15 people from this church working inside the player lounge and trying to get these players to go to their church. It really had nothing to do with natural friendship. It just had to do with going to their church. And so that's what happened. And then Mary went into the Wimbledon, and I was there, of course, working with players. And a similar kind of a thing, you know, we did the prayer time. We spent time together. She and her mother and her brother had rented this big apartment near Wimbledon, and I would go over there in the evening. We'd have music, worship songs. We'd do some Bible studies. We'd pray. We had a small group of people over, and you know, it was a really great time, even up to like 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. She was so excited about her fate, and at that time, that group from Mauritius wasn't there. They weren't at Wimbledon, you know, that's how that all took place. And she went into the quarters finals. Now, Wimbledon actually had given us a private room, which has never happened before, because the people at Wimbledon, who the administrators told, who I knew, some of them were Christians, said that had never happened before. They'd given us a private room to get together to pray and to just spiritually encourage each other. And that their plan was to fix that up and make that into like a prayer room for not just for us, but for other players too. And that didn't happen. But we were doing it that way. And then she was late for a match. You know, she showed up, that her opponent, and I'm trying to remember who her opponent was. It was a well-known player, Petrova, I think. And she showed up late for her match. So she'd been praying with me, but she didn't get right out the door on time. She just decided to stick around late minutes later. She showed up like 5 minutes. She could have been defaulted from Wimbledon quarterfinals, you know, or one of those rounds. And so she showed up. The player was a little bit miffed about that because she had to just wait for 5 minutes. And that was really a sign that there were some problems that were taking place. She went into play. I actually had to leave the tournament early. My ticket had been purchased in advance, and I left the tournament in the quarters, and she went out and played and lost to Venus Williams. She had her chances to win that match. Okay, I was there, and she could have won that match. It was just 1 or 2 points, and Venus was nervous of Mary, the way Mary was playing. I had a lot of confidence, but it was just 1 or 2. Like I say, there were some things that weren't too stable, what was happening around her. And this French coach, it turned out, as I found out from some other ways firsthand, you know, his whole goal was to get to use her name to tell people that he had coached her. And, you know, so he was kind of manipulative and using her for this purpose. And he was very smooth with his words. So it caused a lack of confidence in her. So she'd miss a shot or two that were close, and then she just basically fell apart. And after the match, her brother David came up to me, and he yelled at me, and he goes, God should have allowed her to win that match, and it's your fault. Well, what could I say? You know, what could I do? I just took the approach, well, we need to encourage and cause someone to grow, you know, spiritually, but it's, you know, I don't know how God deals with a person being number one in the world or not. And so that Mary stopped working with David. the relationships fell apart. I didn't really get a chance to spend time with her after that because she went on to other tournaments, but we were still communicating. And she began to bring in this group from Mauritius around her. And from that moment on, they took over her life. So she went into the U.S. Open that year. She played Dmitrieva. She had one person with her. She was still open to hearing from me about Christ's life. But at the same time, she was heavily influenced by this group, and they were staying in contact with her. And they had sent someone, a girl, to be her minder. And she was with Mary Pierce every moment of every day. She'd never leave her side, and she'd stay in the same hotel with her. So all of a sudden, you didn't have like a direct approach to Mary Pierce. It was like through another person, and they were controlling her. And Mary didn't see that, and it started to affect how she approached life, really. Okay, you know, she played Dmitrieva, and she took two timeouts for an injury. It was all in the press. Seemed not fair, and I even talked to Yelena Dmitrieva about it. She said she didn't mind, but it seemed a bit odd, to say the least, that the way it was done. And then she went on, and she made it to the finals of the WTA season-ending championship in Los Angeles. And you know, but at that point, I really didn't have contact because this group had basically taken over. Now, a year or two later, the next year, I saw Mary at the French. And I went over and talked to her. I still have, you know, can communicate. And she said, I've stopped that group. I'm not going to Mauritius. I moved away. They were really bad for me, and they weren't right. And I was really happy because I prayed a lot for her. And she recognized there were some problems with that group. And they had lined her up with a boyfriend to marry. And, you know, that was kind of done in a way where he was very tried to control her too, and she left the group. So I was happy about that, and her mother was happy about that. Her mother was very worried and was telling people. Well, within a matter of 6 months or so, she's back together with the group. They started stayed in contact, as I know, with one person from the group, one lady, and she had communication with her, and that group was able to come back in around her again. And they sent people around her, and all of a sudden it was the exact same thing. There were 10 people at a tournament she was giving credentials to. You know, one time I saw her laying her head on the lap of the founder, Audrey, in the public lounge of the tournament, just like laying her head on her lap. It was so odd and strange. And so we went to a concert, a Christian concert. She invited some of these people from the group, and when I asked them, how do you enjoy the music? I mean, there was like 3,000 students here, and they all loved it, right? Including I was fine with it. And they said, oh, that music is not right. Something wrong with it. It's not godly, you know? The only music that's godly is their music, actually, and that they write themselves and they compose. And so from that moment on, she moved to Mauritius, and that was it. Never heard from her again, hardly at all. You know, she feels she's doing the Lord's leading. She's going to different countries. But it's really all about inviting people into this group. It's not about the church at all and getting people into their church, and even wherever they're, whatever country or city they're from, going to their own church and encouraging them to grow. It's about her church and the people who founded it, and that's it. And that's where Mary's at, and now she's actually trying to go to tournaments, and she's trying to set up where she's inviting players to come into this church, CTMI, and that's an unhealthy situation as I see it, and especially with young people. She's working with very young players in Africa now, junior players, doing the same thing. The whole purpose is to get this church group to be around these players and then get them into this CTMI group. So that's it, and I just wanted to share that about Mary, and I was glad I got a chance to work with her. It really it helped me a lot, and I saw a lot of things that I wouldn't have seen otherwise. I really feel that a player that goes from 48 to number 4 in the world in 1 year's time, it's almost a miracle. Now, she had the tools for it, for sure, but her emotional issues and her spiritual issues were playing into that, and she was also not in very good physical condition. All of a sudden she became much more fit, and just the fact that she could rise up to the level she did. And I really believe in my heart that God is going to use this time that she's going through these situation in Africa and Mauritius. That's going to come out for the best. Now, there may be a lot of pain associated with that, with other people that she has contact with or even with herself. But all we can do is pray, and God can use that. And that's the situation with Mary Pierce.